Marc-André Kamel is the head of a global retail practice at Bain & Co. Marc-André, nice to have you on board today, and clearly we're getting a close-up look at Ocado today. What jumped out to me during the crisis was that clearly there were not enough services out there to meet the demand for delivery. What do you make of the ramp-up we've seen in a short space of time, and now what lies ahead for the sector?
Well, good morning. The combination of the lockdown measures and the safety concerns has pushed shoppers to try online for the first time, to repeat purchase and to adopt the channel. This has created a fantastic surge in demand, and we estimate that 15 to 20% of that surge in demand was not served due to lack of capacity. But at the same time, it has reset the basis for the channel and for the industry, and we estimate, we forecast at Bain, that between 35% and 45% of that increase in demand will survive beyond the ease of the lockdown measures in most markets.
What does that mean in terms of the outlay now required from some of these big grocery stores to try and meet the demand? I mean, we saw some of the build-out extra measures from Sainsbury's and Tesco in recent months, and clearly it was expensive to try and roll out fresh COVID-19 measures. So how much are we going to see in terms of the CapEx spending from a lot of these players in coming months to try and, again, shuffle more of the consumption towards delivery?
Well, the omnichannel transformation had started before the COVID crisis, and some of the largest retailers in the world had already shifted CapEx towards online, towards capacity, etc. Nowadays, with the COVID happening, everybody's talking about increasing capacity. But we at Bain don't believe capacity is the problem. Retailers have always been able to build capacity. The real problem is profitability, because currently the channel has very poor economics. And this 2 to 5 year acceleration in online penetration that we are seeing in most markets could result in a massive dilution of the retailers' profits. It's not as much about the CapEx as it is about the profits.
On that note then, can I ask you about basket size? Because in the height of lockdown, basket sizes clearly went up as consumers wanted more staples in the house just in case. But that's a lumpy old number to try and bank on for future earnings. So what's your view on just how sustainable those basket sizes are for many of these retailers?
Well, it's like the surge in demand. We believe that basket size has increased significantly, sometimes up 50% or more, actually, versus the previous levels. And it is a great help, actually, for the economics of the channel. But with the pandemic actually subsiding and the sanitary crisis being brought under control, hopefully in the next few weeks, it is possible that the average basket size will return to some lower numbers versus the peak. Now, it's one element. There are many other elements that retailers should activate to be able to change the economics, fix the broken economics of the channel, and create something that is more sustainable over the long run.
Marc-André, does it matter if companies ever make money?
We believe it's important for companies to make money, and what we believe is also that it's impossible actually to let this penetration of online grocery just dilute the profits forever, especially that there are things that retailers could be doing to change that and change the shape of the profit curve. Three things in particular. The first one is make online and offline work more seamlessly together and in a more efficient way. One way to do that is to use automation better in the form of centralized fulfillment centers like the ones Ocado is using in the UK, or micro fulfillment centers that are a new thing in the market, but that both of these fulfillment center types have the potential to improve profitability for the least mature grocers, the ones who are still picking manually from their own stores. They could see their profitability improved by 2 to 12 percentage points if they really implement automation. So that's number one. Number two is actually making the consumer pay for this fantastic service of online delivery. Historically, grocers have been very shy about this and have refused to charge this this very valuable service. And this has actually created the problem, the profitability problem. We believe, we understand the challenges, we understand the sensitivities there, but we believe it's now time actually to use pricing to fix a little bit the economic equation. And finally, given that online grocery is now taking a big chunk actually of grocery retail, it is time also for retailers to invent new digital retailing methods, working with their vendors hand to hand with the consumer products companies, and inventing actually new ways of creating long-term mutually beneficial services. It's all around brand activation, and here we believe there is up to 6 percentage points of improvement if they do that.
When will Ocado make money on a regular basis?
Well, it's difficult for me to forecast this. What is interesting is, you know, on the B2C side, Ocado is competing with all the traditional retailers in the UK who are ramping up their omnichannel transformation, and it's going to be a continuously a difficult market to compete in. But Ocado is actually bringing a lot of innovations in the market. Automation is one of them. And what is interesting in the past few years is how they pivoted their model from only doing B2C online grocery to becoming a B2B provider of technology and services for other retailers. And here they have a lot of runway in front of them.
Okay, Marc-André, thank you very much indeed. So it is important for companies to make money, but we don't know when this one will make money, but it still trades at one of the biggest multiples in world retail. Thank you very much indeed for that, Marc-André Kamel, who is the head of global retail practice at Bain & Co.